living in. Let me tell ya. Well, it's a world that man can eat at all. When things are big, that should be small. Who can tell what magic spells we'll be doing for us? And I'm giving all my love to this world, only to be told. I can't see, I can't breathe, nor my will will be.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Ozone. Live from Koreatown, it is the Brothers Millers, known as Omar, and my brother Terry.
The Icons.
Also known as the Swami. Also known as the Atlanta Falcon Swami,
and
ladies and gentlemen.
The Groovy Guru.
Wow. So we got a lot to talk about today. Obviously, this NFL playoff action that we're going to start with. Want to go down under, mate. Hey, great going, mate. We're going to go down under and deal with the Australian Open. Inside joke there, folks. Sorry about that. We got a Super Bowl preview for you. Want to talk about some upsetting news in the world of Major League Baseball, about the Hall of Fame, and a couple young stars lost way too soon. But let's just jump right on in it and get going on this NFL playoff situation.
You want to talk about Julio getting the stretch?
Julio, get the stretch! Wow. Julio ran from Harlem to Jackson, Mississippi yesterday, all on one slant route. Wow. What in the world was going on with the clinic that the Atlanta Falcons put on? I know Omar Dorsey, our last week's guest, is somewhere smiling from Atlanta if his wife let him go, because, man, oh, man, did they put in work. What is going on out there in Atlanta? Matt Ryan, I mean, you've been talking
about
him.
Firepower. Firepower.
And you know what? I really think their defense is underrated.
Way underrated.
Not that the Packers, I wasn't crazy for the Packers. We're on record. Neither one of us thought that the Packers should have beat the Cowboys. Neither one of us thought that the Packers were all world. But what they've done the past 2 weeks between Seattle and the Packers has been, I mean,
very impressive.
Very impressive. Very, very impressive.
They got a bunch of youngsters just getting at it.
They really do. Now, yesterday, Julio Jones put on a stone-cold clinic, but so did the whole Falcons team. Them dirty birds was out there doing it. Now, you've talked about their offense for a long time. I think the defense is better than expected, but, I mean, you got the sack leader. You got the NFL sack leader on your squad, and you still got Dwight Freeney being Dwight Freeney. It's not like, you know, he's some kind of buster.
Well, he doesn't play every down either, so you don't have to worry about him. He's only in there in pass situations where they can just let him go balls to the wall.
I feel like they have a B version of Seattle's Legion of Boom, which is not saying, I'm not trying to disrespect them at all. It's just like that Legion of Boom might be the best defense, you know, top five, of all time.
The greatest of all time.
Yeah. So, but I feel like they have a B-plus version of that, maybe a B version of that. I don't know. But
they have a bunch of youngsters out there that can really get at it. They have speed. They have speed, great speed on defense and offense.
They got great speed on defense, which is very important. And the thing about that to me is the main thing that they have is that they're always playing from ahead.
Yes.
This is a serious problem. You talked about it a few weeks ago, and I thought the Dallas Cowboys would be able to dismantle that formula. We'll never know because the Dallas Cowboys are going fishing. But one thing that I say, I love that Atlanta commits to their identity. Atlanta is saying, look, we got crazy offense. And if we get the ball, we're getting some points somehow or another. We're getting a field goal. Most likely, we're getting a touch.
Most likely, they're getting a touch. They always get a touch.
They need a touch. I need to get in there. And so, but they commit to that. I haven't seen them vary from that, and I haven't seen the team make them vary from that. I also like the fact that they continue to pour it on like they were in a college game.
Right, and not only that, what they do is that they don't get into third and long situations. So it's like third and 14, it's maybe third and 4, third and 6 at the most usually, and then they convert.
Not a lot of penalties, which is a big deal.
Yeah, not a lot of turnovers either, although Matt Ryan tried last game.
He tried two times.
Yeah.
Terrible situation on that snap. But, you know, this is what we're seeing here. Let's look at this. They put up 10 in the first, 14 in the second, 13 in the third, and 7 in the fourth. And you know good and well they could have put up another 7. They didn't even challenge a call that was obviously a fumble that they would have got the ball back on. Like, man, forget it.
Let them breathe.
Even though that would have helped me in my DraftKings league. I wish they would have done that so then Tevin Coleman could have ran wild. But maybe they just wanted more work for the defense. Who knows? But, I mean, how are you going to stop this offensive juggernaut known as the Atlanta Falcons. I've maintained.
Headed by the one-headed monster, Julio Jones.
I mean, he's like a five-headed monster. That dude is for 10,000 leagues under the sea, so deep.
Everybody talks about that crazy catch he made going over the middle, but they should have talked about the pass interference that happened because the guy hit him before he even caught the ball.
I mean, tippy-tippy Rawls up and down the line. I was very impressed with his footwork. He dragged his foot. He got in his zone late. He's up sideline. I mean, Julio was out there.
Forget about it.
I saw him frying some chicken at the side of the vending machine at the Dirty Burger.
Then he sold a three-piece for about $3.49.
I was like, wow, Julio, man, you're all over the field. Yeah, dog, you know how it is. But, I mean, I couldn't believe it. I really couldn't believe it. And again, it's not that the Packers are the most impressive team in the tournament. What was impressive is that the Packers were able to smoke and mirrors their way past the Cowboys, yes, past the Giants,
yes,
both teams which had them down and should have beat them.
Yes.
And I was on a thread with a bunch of my friends from college who were all Division I football players, and only one of them from the beginning saw that this game being lopsided for the Packers. I mean, for the Packers, really. Lopsided as in it was an uphill battle. And it was a trip because I just can't believe how people buy into the allure of certain guys.
Well, I think the media has a lot to do that with that. You know, look at how they jumped ship on Aaron Rodgers yesterday. You know, once he got down, everybody turned to the Matt Ryan, you know, bandwagon.
I don't know about that because I feel like all across America, people were watching the games and people were like, oh, Aaron Rodgers is going to come back. And they continued that on the commentary. They didn't jump ship. They
pumped
up Matty Ice. I mean, the game was already 100-point spread in the fourth. Of course they're going to jump off. I'm talking about during the game. It was 24-0 at halftime. The game was over. The game was over at 7-0, real life.
The game was over at 7-0.
The game was over. I told my friends, I said, this is about to be a blowout. They didn't believe me. I said, did Swami told me.
Yeah, because thank you. Because what happens is that they get the lead, then you go 3-and-out, or you don't get your points, they miss their field goal. First of all,
that was huge.
In the playoffs, you can't keep kicking field goals with a team to score touchdowns. It doesn't work.
It doesn't work.
You have to go for it on 4th-and-1 and 4th-and-2.
Doesn't work.
Doesn't work.
And we just saw that same thing happen in the other game. So recapping those games, I mean, the numbers are really, really silly in this in that Packer game. That Packer at Falcon game, 392 yards for Matt Ryan.
Yeah, Julio had 180.
Julio needs 180 yards himself. That is silly.
Let me ask you this. Did Julio?
Man, he went. He got the stretch. He went and did it. But I think that it's going to be a different story against Bill Belichick and the Patriots. I do because I've yet to see them get blown out in the big dance. I haven't seen it.
They might not get blown out, but they're going to lose, and they're probably going to lose by more than a touchdown. And this is a problem I feel like with sports fans because we all buy into the fact that Tom Brady is not getting – after watching that first game, it looked like both Ben and Tom Brady were moving in slow motion. That game, that Atlanta game was moving so fast.
That game moved fast.
With Aaron Rodgers.
And that's the point. What Bill Belichick will do is figure out a way to slow that game down so that that game moves in slow motion, which is it to his advantage. Now, the problem that I saw, again, I have to give you credit. Mike Tomlin made no adjustments. The team seemed like they were not prepared because when they put up all the statistics of what Tom Brady's done to the Steelers throughout his career when they run a zone, they were ugly, and yet they went out there and they ran a zone.
He ran a zone, and what did Tom Brady do? He
destroyed them.
He gave them to Tom Brady.
He gave them to Chris Hogan.
He gave him to number 12. Give me a Tom Brady, please.
He gave him the ball to Chris Hogan, and they refused to guard him. How do you miss the guy that torches you the whole first half, and then he comes out and he torches you the whole second half?
Forget about it. I don't even want to get torched in the first quarter by a guy who lines up and doesn't get touched
by a guy
at
who's a C-plus receiver, B-minus right. receiver.
But he's lined up on the line of scrimmage. He releases and never is touched or guarded.
No bump, no run. He's just out there alone.
And he left the line and just waved his hand up like, whoa, can you believe this? Whoa.
Yeah, it's like they were playing 10-on-11. Yeah. It was like, wait a minute, we don't have a guy out
and
here.
And they
or something.
Didn't chew anybody out. Nobody made the adjustments. Even after the second half, in the second half, nobody made adjustments. They just kept rolling with it, and they just kept getting the tar beat out of them.
Let's hear what Mike Tomlin had to say after the game, because I was pretty disappointed.
You know, I tip my cap to those guys. They're the champions of the AFC, and rightfully so. You know, not a lot went our way tonight, not only in terms of the final score, but just how the game was played. They're to be complimented for that. We didn't get the things done that we wanted to get done, really. on offense or on defense and on special teams in a consistent enough manner for it to be competitive and close, and some of the splash plays that you look for in those competitive and close games, things that we've done during the stretch run that we've had over the second half of the season. Just not enough positive things in terms of the style of play for those things to unfold. So the result is the result. Be happy to address any questions you might have.
Le'Veon Bell's condition, could you give any kind of...
You know, he's got a groin injury. He wasn't able to be effective and get back in the game for us. So I don't have anything other than that.
I mean, that's Mike Tomlin, folks. That's him talking. He goes on for about 5 minutes where I don't know if he reveals anything special. None of the Steelers seem like they really revealed anything in the post game that was...
Right. He manned up.
He owned it, which is always something that you have to admire because Mike Tomlin always owns it. Let's hear what longtime Patriots supporter Trucker Dave has to say.
Big O, good morning. What's going on?
Trucker Dave, live on the OZone. What's going on is a Super Bowl preview, and your Patriots performed. We just wanted to check in and get your take on these games. We're really disappointed, I was at least, that Mike Tomlin didn't seem to make any adjustments to his plan. He went out there and played exactly how he's always played, and the same result happened. Now, what did you see happen in that Patriots game yesterday?
I saw exactly what happened, exactly what you said. I mean, when he got down on the one-yard line and he didn't even go with a quarterback sneak with Big Ben, first they go in the one-yard line and you get turned away. That's all you need to see, man. I said, that's game right there.
Wow, that's a good point. There was not enough aggressive play calling in general, and I don't know what makes you play a conservative game. You're never going to win a conservative game in Foxborough.
Especially a playoff game.
That's what I was about to say. In the regular season, you're not going to win a conservative game.
You need the trick bag.
You need everything. And you see, Bill Belichick goes to the trick bag.
All the time.
He goes to the flea flicker. He goes to whatever you need. He goes to lining up a guy that's an out receiver in the slot. He goes to all sorts of different angles. Once again, it seemed like Bill Belichick knew his opponent's personnel better than his opponent knew his own personnel. And one thing that bounced their way was Le'Veon Bell got hurt, because I do have to say, at the beginning of the game, Le'Veon Bell was doing the Pac-Man dance back there, and he was moving the ball.
It sure was. That, you know what? It just, once he went out, you could look at his face and look at the demeanor on his face, and he knew that he wasn't right. And that changed the whole game.
And then you could look at the demeanor on everybody else's face and see that they just didn't believe. Even though D'Angelo Williams went out there and ran well, I felt like he was very...
Oh, he's a first-string running back.
Yeah, and he was very effective. It just didn't have that allure that they needed. Like, we have our whole team. There seemed to be a mental element to it. And we've talked about it here on the OZone. Big Ben doesn't look like he's 100%. But what I will say, Big Ben put a lot of balls on the money, and Sammy Coates left his hands in El Segundo. I don't know what happened to Sammy Coates' hands. I don't know what happened to any of the Steelers' hands except for Antonio Brown.
Sammy Coates lost his hands in the sixth week.
Man, guys cannot catch the ball in the NFL. What is going on? Why do you think that the Patriots receivers can catch and so many other guys drop passes? Even in that Atlanta Falcons game, Trucker Dave, we saw the Falcons drop passes. It's just that their offense was so overwhelming, it didn't seem to matter.
Well, what happens with the Falcons, they have so many different options, different weapons that they can use. It's just like, you know, there's so much pressure on you when you're playing the Falcons that I feel like almost every time you get the ball, you have to score.
You have to score.
And the difference in New England to me is, in New England, it's like a football university, you know, and it just doesn't look like the other teams are as serious as they are about what they're doing. I'm sure they are, but it just doesn't seem like that, you know?
Yeah.
So when you go to New England, I mean, you got to act like if it were me, when they deferred, when Pittsburgh deferred and they kicked off, I right there kick an onside kick. I take my chances.
Wow, that's a good point.
We have everything good against us, and what do we have to do to beat them? I told you before the game that it was a bad matchup. I told you that. I said they're not going to win. It's a bad matchup. They play zone defense. They don't get any pass rush, and they're going to sit back there and wait for one of the best quarterbacks ever to make a mistake. Get out of here, man.
You can't wait. You got to apply pressure to Tom Brady. And you can see his feet are getting a little bit slower, but his accuracy is as sharp as ever. Man, that Duplo throws a pretty ball. I wonder about How do you go back there and allow guys to just totally and completely torch you? Guys that are not necessarily A receivers are just out there running amok. You don't have Gronk.
Not even touched.
You don't even, I mean, I'm
amazed
by
that.
I'll tell you something I never thought I would say is that the Texans played the Patriots better than the Steelers did. Because despite the final score, the Texans were in that game deep into the game, like into the third quarter. And that Steelers game was pretty much over from the word go.
But unfortunately, the Chiefs didn't make it because the Chiefs were the only team that could actually beat them.
So now let's talk about Super Bowl matchups. It's very, very hard to bet against Tom Brady and Bill Belichick in the Super Bowl. They're 4-2 in the Super Bowl. The guy has left six Super Bowls with the lead. Tom Brady's left the field six times in the Super Bowl with a chance to get ringed up. That's unbelievable. Now, and he's played against some monster teams. Now, this Atlanta Falcons team is a monster offense. I mean, I was talking to T yesterday, and he said, really, it's possibly the most complete offensive team that he's ever seen. And that could be true. But defense wins championships, and I think the Patriots' defense is underrated. I also think that it's ridiculous that they're the favorite. What's your take on that, Trucker Day?
Well, my take on it is Atlanta kind of reminds me of like when New England played Philadelphia in the Super Bowl. They're not playing a team like Seattle. They played Philadelphia in the sense that Philadelphia put a lot of pressure on Tom Brady. And I think that can be a mistake, like as far as if they're blitzing him. Because you got to remember, Atlanta's going to be starting three rookies on defense against him. And even though what Atlanta did to Green Bay yesterday is this. They got speed on defense, and that made Aaron Rodgers get rid of the ball quicker than – he only got sacked twice, and he had to get rid of the ball quicker than he wanted to, meaning that, you know, that's a problem, man.
And so he's way more mobile than Tom Brady.
Yeah, and you can just put pressure. They actually sent an extra blitzer, but you can put pressure on him with that front four.
You can put pressure on him with the front four. You got Dwight Freeney out there who's older, kind of like Harrison. Harrison looked like his youth last week, and then it looked like it caught up to him this week.
But see, that's the tricky thing about age.
And that's the taxing thing about not winning the home field advantage.
Sure is.
Exactly. And just last week, Aaron Rodgers was considered the greatest quarterback in history.
You're right.
Now, he's just an average guy today, you know, who ran out of his weapon. So amazing how things change just one week in NFL. And it's a lot harder in an NFC to get out of the AFC. So the teams that really get out of the NFC are really, really tough teams, not taking anything away from the Patriots.
Wow. So then what do you think happens? What's your prediction? Being a Patriots supporter, what do you think happens?
You know what? I really have to look at it right now. I mean, they have 2 weeks, and I see a big problem with the matchup with Julio Jones because, you can't put Malcolm Butler on Julio Jones. He's like 5'9". So you have to probably put Eric Rowe or you have to put Logan Ryan on him. Logan Ryan did pretty good against Demetrius Thomas, who's about the same size as Julio Jones, but he doesn't have the same athleticism as Julio Jones. So I mean, in this matchup, if there was any time that a team could really beat New England, I think the Atlanta Falcons have a legitimate chance.
Yeah.
I think they got a
They remind me of that Ram team, of that Greatest Show on Turf team. They remind me a lot of that squad where Kurt Warner had guys putting up crazy numbers.
Yeah.
Except for that's like them with Marshall Faulk, plus you add another Marshall Faulk.
Yeah, you have two running backs.
This is a serious problem.
That's serious business in the backfield. I mean, serious business. The way that they alternate them, they change the pace of the game with them. It matters what position that they're in, how they use them. It's a problem.
It's a serious problem.
It's a serious problem, and you're wondering, like, okay, are those that trade of Chandler Jones, this is a game where you need it. Is that going to come back to
and Jamie Collins.
Is Jamie Collins, will that hurt you, or will your greatness let you get by with that? You know, we got some unanswered questions, and I'm sure the ratings are going to be through the roof.
Ratings going to be through the roof. Anytime Tom Brady's in the Super Bowl, the ratings are go crazy. The ratings are nuts. Yeah. But I will say, this is, if I was a Patriots fan, I would be nervous. Let's say that. Because I don't see, especially if yesterday's performance from Julio Jones was him not at 100%, 2 weeks of world-class treatment for a world-class athlete is going to make him 100%. And I see it as it's all about whether or not Atlanta's young guys can respond under the lights. I have long since said that Matt Ryan is a choker, and I think that it's their Super Bowl to lose as opposed to New England's to win. And I believe that if those young guys, if the lights aren't too bright for those young guys, then sky's the limit. I mean, they could have a potential dynasty on their hands.
They could.
You add a couple pieces here and there defensively, man, you shore up the defense a little bit. They got
well, those kids are going to mature, so once they mature, even more so, they're going to be even that much more tougher.
Get you that monster linebacker is what you need to acquire.
Yeah.
Yeah, but look at the matchup. Look at these two matchups. Okay, you have a problem with Julio Jones. So what does Bill Belichick usually do? He takes the good corner, then he puts the safety over the top. But the problem that he has in this game is he's got another physical receiver on the other side in Muhammad Sanu.
Exactly.
That's a huge problem.
And a speedster in the slot in Taylor Gabriel,
who likes to drop passes.
Yeah, he played too much. He usually doesn't drop passes like that, though. That was uncharacteristic of him.
I don't know, but I know that they got problems. I know that much because you got five guys to throw the ball to.
It's a problem.
It's a problem.
Right. It's not an issue.
It's a problem, man. If the Patriots win this, then they earned it. That's what I'll say.
I'm taking the Falcons. I'm with you. Now, let's that opens up another bag there. If they win this Super Bowl, you have to consider Tom Brady the greatest quarterback of all time.
I already do.
And I hate to say that, but you do.
It's hard to give him over Joe Montana, though.
It is, because Joe never lost. But.
And you always have to take the era into effect. Okay. Last week, when Carly went up to Brady, Ray Lewis came out, and Ray Lewis was so upset because Tom Brady wanted that penalty. Tom Brady, later on in the week, when they asked him in radio in Boston, if, you know, why, you know, we heard about Ray Lewis had something to say about you complaining about that. Ray Lewis said, come on, man, that's just football. And Tom Brady disappointed me, and he said, I just wanted to make sure the refs were aware of that. Aware of what? He didn't hit you late.
No.
You know what I mean?
So, aware that he's Tom Brady. Duh.
Just like Aaron Rodgers does. He does the same thing. These guys sit back there and cry.
When you say somebody is better than the best, you have to factor in the error. Joe Montana was going up against Lawrence Taylor.
The best.
Ever.
The guy that changed defense in all of football.
Yes.
It did not throw one interception in four Super Bowls. So think about that.
Come on, man.
It's ridiculous.
I mean, this is hard. This is rarefied air here.
It's better than Joe Montana. Think about it before what you said. He beat John Elway. He blew John Elway out.
Blew them out. That game wasn't even competitive.
Yeah.
You didn't even need to watch that game after halftime.
Wow. So, you know, you have to really think about what you say. I have to go, you guys. But nice talk to you.
Chucker Dave, great having you. Which part of America are you in?
I'm in the good state of Georgia.
He gives you.
All right, now,
go get him, Dirty Bird. Thanks for calling in.
And I'll tell you who's getting the poop put in their face. It's Roger Goodell.
Oh, wow. How about them trolling Roger Goodell?
Go, Goodell. Go, Goodell.
How about that? The whole stadium gave it to him.
Good.
Yeah, he doesn't seem like the best guy as far as the way he handles things in the league. I mean, I'm mad at him as a Raiders fan. It does. And personal as per the owner's bidding.
Yes.
For whatever that secret clandestine thing is that they have in their interest. Because I tell you what, as a Raiders fan, we really could have used Alden Smith back.
Yeah, you could have. against it with no reason why.
Just because I said so.
Yeah, and you have to live with that.
That's unacceptable.
That's unacceptable. They need to get the CBA together because you got to get a guy like him, take some of that power away from him.
Yeah.
And now Tom Brady and him gets to go try to stuff it down his throat.
Yeah. Deflategate.
Tommy Terrific.
Man.
This is going to be a good one.
You know what else is a good one?
What?
It's the 5-4 Club. Did you know, fellas, that for $65 a month, you can receive a box of clothing that's worth more than $200 every single month? Think about it. Your wardrobe's going to come together in such a short amount of time. Summer, spring, winter, and fall, folks, the 5-4 Club is here for you. I'm wearing some 5-4 right now. My jeans are smooth. It's been raining like crazy in Los Angeles, and I'm happy the 5-4 Club's been taking care of me. They sent me a raincoat that I needed. Fantastic, folks. Go to 5-4club.com, put in promo code Omar, Find yourself with a discount, ladies and gentlemen. How's your Fight Force clothing going lately?
It's going awesome.
Yeah?
They gave me that rain jacket that I wore out there to the CES. It was really nice.
You're awesome.
It was stylish.
Wireless. Living it up in the city. Wow, Julio got the stretch.
I told you he was going to get the stretch.
You did. And all these fools talking about turf toe. Get out of here.
Yeah, okay.
Get out of here.
Julio takes the fourth quarter off nowadays.
Julio's giving you the Michael Jordan.
Yeah, he's giving you the Scotty Mike right now.
He takes the
towel over his head.
It's not even. Why are we even here? Why are we even here? Moving on into something that we love, our favorite sport, folks, is Major League Baseball. And there's a sad loss, two sad losses in the baseball family this weekend. Two terrible, terribly tragic situations took place. Kansas City Royals ace Yordano Ventura got in a car accident down in Dominican Republic, his homeland. And there's not many details out now, but we know that the young man was killed in the car crash. He was only 25 years old. I mean, he was a monster. The kid had so much potential.
So much potential. 100 miles an hour, just like it was nothing. I think
an electric arm.
Oh, my goodness.
That electric boogaloo coming out of his arm. He was like a prototype of Pedro Martinez.
Yeah.
With the bad attitude on the mound,
yeah.
Which is personally how I like my pitchers. I don't need a nice pitcher. I like my guys mean.
Got to be mean.
Yeah.
I like get my under guys that chin. Mean. Little chin music. Keep you straight. Keep you honest.
But it's really unfortunate. We also lost Andy Marte. I knew him most from the Cleveland Indians. He also passed away in a separate car crash. And it's always so surprising when tragedy touches professional sports. We had a lot of it last year. 2016 was just a monster that I'd like to keep in the rearview mirror when it comes to tragedy in general. But unbelievable. You wake up. That was the first news that I saw. I saw it flash across on Bleacher Report that Yordano Ventura, and I thought it was going to say something, you know, some young silly stuff or something about, because he was also seemed like a jokester. You would see those videos with him and everything. I thought maybe he pranked Hosmer or something like that, and then it said he passed away in a car crash. Just really hurt my heart, man. Really, really hurt my heart.
So many car accidents down there.
Yeah, it seems like in all of the second to third world countries, the roads aren't together. You know, there's just a lot of situations that are variables, but everybody can understand, because if it's where you're from, it's just where you're from. And you're going where you grew up. Now you've done well. I went down to the Dominican Republic for Big Poppy's charity event, where he actually has a charity that does brain surgeries on children that wouldn't otherwise be done.
Wow.
Because the finances aren't available. And he comes out there and he brings a bunch of celebrities and a bunch of other ball players out, and we raise a bunch of money and we give a bunch of money. We have a good time, and these kids end up getting well. Well, you ride around on those country roads and anything can happen. And you can tell when you're out there, when you feel it, when you're off of the reservation, if you will, when it comes to the tourist resorts and this, that, and the other.
Mm.
But it's just unfortunate every single time it happens. It's just such a great loss. You see these young guys passing away with the they got the world in the palm of their hands, and anything could have been theirs. I mean, the guy already won a World Series, and he really matured. 25 years old. He's played in two World Series, and I was very surprised, because the year before, when they hit that Grand Slam, I think it was Brandon Moss hit a Grand Slam off of him, the dead center field in Kauffman, that was the go-ahead Grand Slam, and they brought him in to throw cheese, and Brandon Moss couldn't have been happier about it.
Mm.
And I think it was Brandon Moss that went deep on him. And I said right there, we were watching the game together, I said, oh, they just ruined this kid's career. And he bounced back. He bounced back and pitched well against the Giants in that World Series, and then he bounced back and he pitched well against in that whole run for the pennant run, and then the World Series run the year they won the World Series against the Mets.
Now, Oscar Tavares was his friend as well, right?
And the game that he won, Oscar Tavares, for those of you who don't know, is another major league ball player who died in a tragic scenario last 2 years ago,
I believe
it was, in a car accident, also in the Dominican, in October of 2015, if memory serves me correct, because Yordano Ventura started his World Series game with an RIP and a tribute to Oscar Tavares, either on his cleats or on his hat or on both. In, I think it was game 4 or 5. And
pitched one of the best games of his career.
Sure did. I mean, he shut them down that day. He shut the Mets down.
I think he went seven scoreless.
Yeah, it might have went seven scoreless Williamson.
Oh, yeah, scoreless Corliss.
And then passed it over to freaking Wade. And then passed it over to Greg Holland back then. You remember? They went. they used to go. Was it Joaquin Soria? Wasn't Soria.
Yeah, it was Soria.
What's the other homie's name?
It's Holland and Soria.
It was Holland, Soria, and Miller, right? There's one other dude that we're missing right now. Herrera. That he handed over to Kelvin Herrera, and then Kelvin handed it over to Wade. Mm-hmm. Wade handed it over to Greg Holland.
Good job.
And then they won the World Series is what ended up happening. And it's just it's always surprising, and it's always heartbreaking because you see all the potential. I mean, that kid could have become anything, you know, as he was already somebody, but he could have become anything within the game and maturing as a young man. You see him maturing, you know.
As a player, he had unlimited potential as a pitcher.
Unlimited potential. And Andy Marte got to do 7 years, I think it was 7 or 8 years of service in the majors. I mean, to make it to the major leagues to hit your pitch your way off of the island and make it to the major leagues is such an accomplishment that I think here in the States that we really don't appreciate, because our version of the ghetto and poverty is different than third world versions of ghetto and poverty.
Right. It serves the boxing community well, but not baseball in a sense.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. And it's such an accomplishment. I remember I got to have a conversation with Pedro Martinez, and you know, to see him, Big Poppy, a lot of these guys, what they're able to do with their family and friends and strangers and just their fellow countrymen, to see what they're able to do when they, quote, make it, and these guys go back and they do the right thing, it makes you understand a lot better, you know, what this really means.
Right.
Well beyond.
And it's an island, so everybody's pretty tight-knit.
Yeah. Well, and it's an island that on the other side of that island is maybe one of the most impoverished nations in the entire world.
Yes.
And nobody talks about it, but the connection between the Dominican and Haiti is, you know, undeniable. So appreciate your lives, folks. You never know what can happen day to day. It's a really unbelievable situation. What else to me is an unbelievable situation is that Hall of Fame voting that took place last week.
Oh, my goodness. They need to throw these writers out.
Now, what is the criteria to get to vote for the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame?
You have to be a writer for 10 years, I do believe, and that's just about it.
Well, if you talk to my first grade teacher, I've been writing now for a good 30 years.
Baseball writer.
Oh, okay, sorry. But for those of you who didn't see it, big, huge controversy, because Jeff Bagwell and Ivan Rodriguez got voted into the Hall, along with Tim Raines. But one of these three is not like the other. And the one that's not like the other is Tim Raines, because there's no cloud of performance-enhancing drug use that
right.
over Tim Raines' head like there is of the other two guys. And Jose Canseco just went stone crazy, and I can understand why.
Right.
Not even to lobby himself to get in the Hall, but to lobby other juicers to get in the Hall.
What is the criteria? If you're going to keep the juicers out, keep them out. You can't, what, do you have a favorite juicer?
More or less. You know what's happened is that these writers seem like they make it personal. And it makes no sense
totally
whatsoever.
Personal.
I talked to an Ozone listener, Pastor Larry, an Ozone listener, mm-hmm. who said, he brought up a great point. He said, you know what? Tim Raines, on his first year on the ballot, Tim Raines got 24% of the vote. And now Tim Raines just made it into the Hall. That was 15 years ago, dude. Tim
He's
Raines,
been on the ballot for 10 years.
10 years. Tim Raines has not gotten one more base hit. He's not gotten one more stolen base.
Jeff Bagwell's been on there for 7.
Now, what is – it's so personal, and why should I believe that these writers know more about the game than me or anybody else that I know that knows the game?
Exactly. And you're talking about leaving off Trevor Hoffman and Vladimir Guerrero.
What in the world is going on?
And you
Let's start with Trevor Hoffman, because we can go all day on Vlad. What else can Trevor Hoffman do? Trevor Hoffman is the all-time saves leader. I saved all the games, dude.
What do you want me to do?
What do you want me to do?
More than Mo.
I saved more than Mo. Played in the World Series, I do believe.
He did.
Yeah, in 98. They lost to the Yankees. Yeah, yeah. What do you want from Trevor Hoffman? And like you said, he saved games two different ways, which is super impressive.
Yes, he blew out his arm, and he went to the changeup.
He was a power pitcher. Mm-hmm. It was a traditional closer. Then he blew out his arm and continued to save games being a finesse pitcher.
He restructured his game.
He restructured his deal. And his collective bargaining agreement was great.
And he served them. And it's just terrible for the writers to do this to these guys, because it just turns into a pissing contest.
Yeah, because the Hall in and of itself is supposed to be sacred. Probably the most sacred in all of sports, the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame. Is the hardest thing to get into in all sports.
Yeah, but now it's tainted. You know, you're doing stuff like, you know, you're letting all the juicers in, and then you want to pick the juicers that you can't or don't want to let in. I mean, if you're going to let Bagwell in and Rodriguez, you got to put Bonds in.
Bonds should be the first juicer.
You
got to
put
in.
Clemens in.
Roger Clemens won 350 some odd games, dude.
He needs
now
to be
you're
in.
Just saying because you didn't like the way that
that's
they treated.
That's all it comes down to.
You didn't treat me right in the dugout or in and the
this is my get back.
And now
you.
I'm going to give you some get back.
It doesn't make any sense at all.
It doesn't.
And then realistically, if that's the case, what's wrong with Mark McGwire? If we're going to add juicers, just like Jose Canseco said. What's wrong with Mark McGwire? What's wrong with Sammy Sosa?
So Roger Clemens has been on the ballot for 5 years, and so has Barry Bonds. And they keep talking about they're gaining momentum, and they should. So what is it that some of the writers are dying out, and then the younger writers are going to vote them in?
Maybe that's what it is, but I know that they need to take away this anonymous voting. I know that if you have a vote, your ballot should be broadcast, because whoever the idiots were who didn't vote for Ken Griffey Jr., the two guys that didn't vote for Ken Griffey Jr.,
they should be thrown out.
They should be thrown out of every Major League Baseball venue possible.
Yeah,
you shouldn't even be able to come back.
You can't even look at the game at home.
You don't even watch the game on your phone. I don't want to hear nothing.
I'm checking. I'm watching.
I'm in you. So
Are the same guys who voted Mike Trout as the MVP this year. I mean,
yeah, on a losing team.
Yeah, on
a team that didn't matter from the word go.
Right. It was the most valuable player of a loser.
There's just a lot of problems with the system, and I think that we don't seem to understand how we lose credibility when we do it like this. You know,
right.
You lose credibility when Vladimir Guerrero, arguably the greatest Latin player in the history of baseball, statistically, maybe other than Big Poppy, is not in the Hall on his first attempt, because you have the Hall entry and then you have the upper echelon, which is first ballot.
Exactly.
Which is the Ozzie Smiths of the world.
Which separates the Hall from the Hall.
And certain guys should be in there.
Yeah.
Trevor Hoffman should be in there.
I'm not even a crazy Trevor Hoffman fan.
Me neither. I feel like that needs to be stated.
Yeah.
I'm
a crazy Vlad fan.
Yeah, I know this. I know this.
And Vlad, he's a 5-2 player. He played the game the right way.
A once-in-a-generation guy.
Yeah, once-in-a-generation guy, and nobody can justify not having him in the Hall.
How many statistical leaders, it's like the all-time average leader, all-time hit leader, all-time RBI leader, all-time home run leader, all-time blah, 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 are not in the Hall? You think about it. You have Barry Bonds, not in the Hall, all-time home run leader.
Pete Rose.
All-time hit leader. Trevor Hoffman, all-time saves leader. Come on, man. What are you doing, Hall of Fame?
Credibility is an issue.
It's an issue to me. And I really, realistically, I mean, I've maintained this. I have more of a problem with guys juicing than I do with Pete Rose betting that he's going to win a game. Because one thing I believe him on, even though I know the betting on the games is unacceptable if you're in the league. But I do believe that there's no evidence that he ever bet the Reds to lose. That's saying something to me. He always bet on his squad. He believed, and he lost. That's the thing. He lost a lot of money because he believed that they were going to win games they didn't win.
Not like he turned into Donald Trump or nothing, right?
Come on, man. Trust me. It's going to be great. We're going to win.
Huge.
Yeah, this is just it's a very disappointing thing, this Hall of Fame argument. I just don't understand any sort of logic other than it being personal. What else are they saying? And now,
or you're not watching the games. And they say that some of the writers don't have to watch the games and they can still vote.
Absurd.
Which is ridiculous.
So now you're telling me that Jeff Bagwell is in the Hall alongside Willie Mays and Mickey Mantle.
Yes.
And
Bob Gibson. That's what I can tell you. That's what I can tell you.
And Mr. Willie Horton.
Yes.
And Al Kaline.
And Tim Raines.
And Tim Raines.
Yes.
And Ricky Henderson.
Tim Rock Raines. Tim Rock Raines had a great career. If they were going to vote him in, they should have put him in the first ballot, too.
He had a great career.
He had a great career.
And if it wasn't for Ricky Henderson, Rock Raines would be much more appreciated for what it was that he was doing. He just happened to play in the same time, you know, as one of my favorite players to ever lace him up. Man, come on, man.
This is disgusting.
It's a real problem. And I mean, and then I think Jack Morris fell off the ballot. Jack Morris isn't good for the Hall to even be considered to continue to vote. Arguably the biggest big game pitcher in the history of Major League Baseball. You want a guy, ladies and gentlemen, if you don't know much about baseball, you want to know about a dude in one game situation. In a one game situation, I can't put anybody over Jack Morris I can think of in my head that I watched.
Yeah. Maybe El Duque.
El Duque shut you down in a big game. But he doesn't shut you down for 10 innings. Jack Morris shut you down with a 10-inning shutout.
A dime.
Are you crazy?
A dime.
A dime against a monster offense.
You got a chance to speak to him, right?
I played celebrity softball with him. I was like a little boy. I was so happy he went deep. Jack Morris. He had a bomb.
Forget about the pitching.
Yeah. He's a big dude. Big dude.
What did he say about that? What did he say about that game?
Man, he said, yeah, that was a good one. That was a really good one. Got a deep voice. Real cool dude. He said, kind of reminds you of Wayne in real life. He looks just like Wayne, like a big version of Wayne.
Come on.
But he's, he actually, we had a great conversation about pitch counts, where he talked about he saw Nolan Ryan throw 150 pitches in one game. He saw Nolan Ryan throw something like 200 pitches in one game. Some game where he had, I think he said he had 12 strikeouts and 16 walks and pitched 9 innings. Something crazy like that.
So I guess he's not a fan of the pitch count.
But it's, you know, Hall of Famers, get your act together. What's going on? What are you guys doing?
I honestly don't feel like they care enough.
I agree, and I think part of that comes from the
actual numbers and statistics and the gameplay.
And there needs to be another commission of some sort of players who vote you in.
Yes, managers, players, ex-players, something. I need something.
I need you to have played the game on a high level.
Yes.
Because if you've never seen 95-mile-an-hour fuzz, I actually can't trust your opinion on who's great and who's not.
Right.
And you haven't seen it in the batter's box yourself.
And you see these guys who turned it around, and then now you're saying that they're not eligible to be in the Hall? Are you kidding? Barry Bonds? I'm not even a Barry Bonds fan.
Neither am I, but Barry Bonds was going to the Hall with or without the juice. I got newsflash for you. Barry Bonds' numbers were silly Pittsburgh.
He's a 4-2 player.
He's a 4-2 player. He was almost like, he's not even 4.5. Every blue moon, he would make you a nice throw, but it was rare. But either way it goes, his four were so far above and beyond what the rest of the field was.
Hit for average, hit for power.
Come on, man. Crazy defense, speed.
Crazy speed. When he got big, when he got on the juice, he couldn't run anymore.
Yeah. Still could score for you,
from second big man run.
He could,
give you the Hulk Hogan run.
He could, let's get out of here, brother. He could score from first on a double still out there in San Francisco in the big part of the park.
Oh, okay, in the big part.
Yeah, for sure. But very disappointing about the Hall. I don't know what they're doing. You know, it was not disappointing.
What?
The sweet taste of Gorilla Life. Ladies and gentlemen, Gorilla Life is life in a bottle. It's a chlorophyll-based drink that has helped my health considerably. Go to GorillaLife.com and check out Gorilla Life. Three ingredients, folks: water, chlorophyll, maybe agave. Get your life together. Purify your blood with Gorilla Life. Life in a bottle. Man, man, man. It's going down under right now, mate.
What's going on there, mate? Good job, mate. Good job, mate.
For those of you who don't know, we're referencing a movie we watched called Lion the other day. Fantastic movie that isn't getting any press.
Oh, not getting any press is one of the best films of the
year. One of the best films of the year, I would say. You know what I'm doing now?
What?
Hands down.
Hands down.
Hands down. One of the big, I would say top five. Top five. It was a great film, and I don't know. For some reason, it's not getting much burn. It's got Nicole Kidman. It's got, what's my man's name? Dev Patel, is it? That was the star of Slumdog Millionaire.
Great work, though.
I mean, he gave you great work.
The kids gave you great work.
Uh-huh. It's got Rooney Mara in it of Girl with the Dragon Tattoo fame, and also of Law & Order SVU fame with an episode titled Fat. I know, because I was in it.
Mm.
And it was a really good movie. You want a movie, go to check out, guys. Go check out Lion. Really good film, deep film about family.
Yeah,
about
watch it with the
faith.
Family.
Yeah, it's about just life, man. How hard life is and overcoming obstacles. Got a lot of good movies this year. Really did. What are some of your favorite movies?
Lion was definitely one of the top tier.
Yeah,
you know, reflecting on a lot of the films, Hell or High Water.
Hell or High Water is maybe my favorite film of the year.
I'll take Lion over.
I can't front on Birth of a Nation.
Yeah, Birth of a Nation was
fantastic, even though it got railroaded
It
got caught in the shuffle of Hollywood and, you know, legal stuff and blah, blah, blah.
I like for films to marinate after
me
the fact.
Me too. I like to think about the film afterwards.
You watch it and then you can't go to sleep. You think about, wow.
I've been thinking about Lion ever since. Yeah. It was a fantastic film.
It really, really...
You know, there's a film nobody's talking about called Hello, My Name is Doris with Sally Field. That was fantastic.
Oh, that movie is fantastic.
Nobody watched it. I watched it in New York City, and that was a great movie.
It sort of reminds me of an old film, Walter Mitty.
Little bit, right?
With Danny Kaye.
Because she's always always dreaming and this, that, and the other. That's funny. Well, who else is always dreaming is the women of the Australian Open right now, because Serena Williams is the top seed that's left at number two. People are dropping like flies down there in Australia, top seeds. And I think that Serena Williams is going to take it again this year. I think she's going to have to end up playing
barring
her sister.
Injury, right?
Yeah, well, it's always that. But I think her sister's playing well. Venus is playing well right now
but
as well.
But she had an injury recently as well, right?
I mean, you know, both of them. I was telling someone yesterday, really the Williams sisters are considered senior citizens in the tennis world in comparison to what used to be. I mean, your tennis career used to be over like 26, 27. And they're 36, 35, or 37, something like that. And they're still balling. I mean, they are so underappreciated as athletes, in my opinion.
I think so, too. But one of the things that they've always done is take care of themselves.
And win.
And win.
That's the other thing they always do.
But the conditioning, you know, was always above code.
Yeah, I agree. And I think on, I don't know. I think on the men's side, we're looking at, we had a major upset happen. Andy Murray, the world number one, got upset, which opens the door to a lot of possibilities. Djokovic lost early, and so now I really wouldn't be surprised if Roger Federer wins another Australian Open. And he's way down in the rankings. You know, he had battled some injuries, some knee injury last year. Then he just had a five-setter against Kei Nishikori, which was a great match.
What happened with your boy from France?
Gael Monfils. Oh, la, la, Monfils. Qu'est-ce qui se passe, mon pote? I don't understand what's wrong with Gael Monfils. I do understand what's wrong with him.
Focus.
Yes, that's all it is. He's the best athlete on the tour.
He can't pull focus.
And he cannot. His shot is always blurry. I just don't understand. He needs to get a new camera assistant because his focus is just out. He lost to Rafael Nadal, which is not, you know, that's not something to scoff at because Rafael Nadal is legit when he's not hurt. But this Monfils character, he never gets it together. I just don't understand. I don't understand why. It seems like he's very satisfied with making it the way that he has. He has endorsements. I don't think he's ever won a major or anything like that, but he's recognizable in the tennis world. He stays within, you know, he floats around the top 10 in the rankings.
Yeah, I think, but the problem is that you know that he has the potential to be more than what he is at this point.
He has the potential to be great.
Yes.
He really has the potential
to be great.
Seems
like he's the only person that doesn't know that.
Yeah. Seriously. I don't know if people in his family aren't telling him or what, but I hope he pulls it together, and I actually hope Roger Federer wins this this Australian Open. It's going to be tough because there's some youngsters out there that can go. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is this awesome 3-on-3 league that Ice Cube has put together
great,
with Allen Iverson.
Idea.
Who else is it? Allen Iverson and who else?
Gary Payton.
GP, Allen Iverson, and Ice Cube founded it, right?
I think so. I'm not positive.
And it is a league. Let's get the name of the league up. It is a league basically for retired NBA players that you still want to watch play, and obviously they still want to play. And you got guys. It's a trip because you got guys getting it together. You have guys. So Ice Cube is the one who founded it. It is Allen Iverson joined it. That's very, very interesting. But you have guys that still want to play. I know I would still watch guys ball.
Especially a 3-on-3.
3-on-3.
It's like a video game almost.
It's like NBA Jam a little bit.
I would love to see a 1-on-1, let alone a 3-on-3. Al Harrington just signed up for it.
You got Kenyon Martin, Jermaine O'Neal, Jason Williams, Allen Iverson, Al Harrington, Ricky Davis. I wonder if Cube is going to play.
I would. I'm sure. Why
not? Yeah. I founded the league.
Squad.
Give me some. That's pretty sweet. I wonder how
it's
going to work out.
Can you imagine Allen Iverson on the 3-on-3?
It's a nightmare. I don't know, though, because, see, Allen Iverson's beauty was that he, because of his size, he was able to space the floor. 3-on-3, the big fellas can clog things up, and you got a serious problem because they don't have to, you know.
Yeah, but if he's still got the handles and the speed, he's a problem.
Yeah, but if you're 7 feet tall and you don't have to run up and down the court, you just stand under the rim, the little man has a problem.
Yeah, but you know what? He's wet.
He was.
You don't think he got it?
I don't know if the jumper's still wet. I don't know what Allen Iverson's jumper looking like.
It's wet. I gotta believe.
You gotta believe, but
I know
3-on-3 is gonna be awesome to watch. Sign me up for season tickets because I've had season tickets to the Clippers this year, and it's been a total waste of money. Jeez Louise, the Clippers started off so promising.
Told you.
Yeah, and now Chris Paul got hurt. His ligament is hurting his thumb.
It's the same two every year. Who is it?
It's Chris Paul. And now Blake Griffin is coming back. It's like it's almost like they time their injuries so that they just don't have to play with each other because they don't like each other that much, it seems. And it's just, come on, man, get it together. Warriors are out there balling. Warriors threw out, I think they're on 7 in a row streak, 7 or 11, something like that.
Yeah, they seem like they're pulling it together. They blew out the Cavs.
And the Cavs struggled yesterday mightily in a nice game Saturday against the Spurs. That was a great game.
Yeah, Spurs came back and got them.
And the Spurs, it's going to be tough to beat the Spurs. It's going to be really, really tough to beat Memphis. Yeah. Really, really tough.
But Memphis never has what it takes to get over the top.
We're going to see.
I think that might be a coaching situation as well.
Well, they've changed coaches, though, a couple times. I agreed when it was Lionel Hollins.
Yeah. But they just can't get over the hump.
Got to get over the hump.
I always feel like you have to interject with a little spot of youth, and they don't have it, you know.
And this is what I saw in the Spurs. Now, the Spurs played without Tony Parker and Pau Gasol, and their youngsters stepped up and balled.
But they're a great organization. What, Deonta Murray was his kid's name?
Yeah.
Murray. He's nice. You got Patty Mills out there. You know, they got a lot of backup players that can go, but he gives them an opportunity to play and to develop.
To develop. And they weren't scared. They went straight at King James. They went straight at.
Yeah.
Guys that could be suspect and in other organizations would probably be discarded and then just be the journeyman in the league.
Right.
He'll keep them and turn them into winners.
I don't know how you do that, Danny Green, but he's doing it.
Man, he's doing it. Wow. Well, you got anything else you want to cover?
That was it. I mean, that was pretty action packed.
Action packed.
You're crazy.
Early. You're the straight guy. You're crazy.
Yeah.
Oh, I love it. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to leave you with an easy one. The most important things in life aren't things. Enjoy your life, folks, but take advantage. Every moment is a real gift. This is Omar Miller from the Ozone, peacing you out.
Ozone.
Here's a chance to dance our way out of our constriction. Call the beat freaking up and down the hang-up alleyway. With the groove I only got, we shall all be moved. Ready or not, yeah.